The fans bought half the tickets by post, and then 5,000 queued, some of them for two nights, in hope of obtaining the rest. Here are some of the lucky 2,500 who really are going to see the Beatles at the ABC Ardwick Manchester. The manager makes sure that every member of his staff is ready for the biggest night of the year, able to cope with a terrific audience response evoked everywhere by the Beatles. Paul McCartney gets the full treatment, the kind the fans have taught him to expect. The boys show the press their latest present. They're a natural, these fabulous four, bubbling over with fun, getting as much kick out of entertaining as the fans get from them.
Find the strain of this going around the country, this tremendous speed getting you down a bit.
No, we like him. It's great.
You know us. No. You don't find it frightening, this business of being mobbed eternally and having to go through various rigmaroles to get here?
The police get mobbed, we don't.
It's always well organised. Very well organised. Tonight it was very good.
Mm. How did you get here tonight?
The van.
Well, what's so special about them that makes you come out here on such a horrible day?
Well, they're just, they're great. The sound's different.
Do you think they're the best there's ever been?
Oh, yes, definitely.
Would you like to grow up to be a Beatle?
Yeah.
We have always thought that it might be a good question to put to Mr. Kenneth Dodd and the members of the Beatles. To what extent do they attribute their success to their hairstyles? And we'll start by asking that question now of Mr. Ken Dodd.
We call it her in Liverpool, you see. We always had the Judy with the fur her. A fellow went into one of those shops once in Liverpool where they sell those, minks and things. And he says, the girl, he said, give us one of those furry coats. I say, I beg your pardon. Is that what fur? He said, fur the Judy. Who do you think?
Do you think that he owes a lot of his success to his hairstyle, fellas?
No, I don't think it helped at all.
It probably would have been better if it was bald.
Bald? No, but with the teeth, I think the teeth and the hair, all the gimmicks, you know, I think you have to have a... I think you definitely have to have a gimmick.
Oh, about yes, the nose?
You've all got gimmicks, haven't you, Lloyd? Eh? What about the nose?
Yeah.
What about the nose? He's a Martian. Actually, we were writing this film script for the boy. You know, the boy's making this new film, and we've been writing the script. And actually, we've cast Ringo in the part of King Charles on account of the thing, you know. And he goes along to Nell Gwynn and pinches her Jaffas. And...
Tell us more about this picture. We didn't know about this.
Oh, yes, we've written the thing. Oh, I'm writing the part. I'm writing the script, yes.
You dear.
Yes, with the with Naughty Ass University, you know, the help of the people, the professors there. He's King Charles. John is a courtier, and in the in this film, he wears a long golden wig with all beautiful curls,
very nice.
And a blue velvet jacket, and like sort of knickerbockers with lace around the bottom, and buckle shoes with diamante clips on. And he's sort of walking around on the film set, and there's a policeman standing on the side, and he said, we'll pinch him when he comes off.
What's he supposed to be doing, though? I mean,
well, John, he's a peasant. He's an evil son. Thingy, he's...
He's
an evil...
An evil-smelling peasant.
Why is he an evil-smelling
peasant?
Come on,
stand where
I am. You're finished. Yeah. And Paul is a jester, you see, and he's always making the king laugh. Yeah. Every time he stands in his head, the king laughs like anything. He wears a kilt.
Getting back to this group, Ken, have you no ambitions to form a group yourself?
Love with the boys.
Yeah.
Kenny and the Cockroaches.
No, I mean, Kenny and the Cockroaches.
Or Doddy and the Diddy Man.
Yeah, what about yourself?
Ringo and the Layabouts.
Would you not form one yourself, Ken?
Yes, I'd like to, yes, because the only thing is I'd have to change my name, you see. I'd have to have a name like Cliff or Rock, something earthy.
Well,
I don't know, eh?
Cliff Dodd.
No.
Rock Dodd.
No, let's invite suggestions for an earthy name for me.
Yeah, well, what about that fellow?
Sod.
So far, all British pop stars have not made a tremendous impact on the States. How do you think you're going to fare?
Well, I can't really say, can I? I mean, is it up to me? No. I mean, I just hope we go all right, you know.
Are you going to vary your act at all for the American audience?
No, I mean, we haven't really got an act, so we'll just do what we do, stand there, sing and twitch.
There have been a number of stories in the press recently about you being under some nervous strain. Is there any truth in this?
No. No truth whatsoever. I think because Paul had flu the other week, we had to cancel a show. They all seem to think we're cracking up, but we're not.
With all this extraordinary publicity you've been having recently, what effect is this having on your private lives?
Oh, we've got no private life. No, it's we don't mind, you know. That's why we do the, we're still playing. If we minded the kids, you know, wrecking our private lives, we wouldn't do it. But we love them, so they can do what they like, you know, as long as they don't rip us to bits.
This intense publicity must be a considerable strain. How long do you think it'll last?
How long will it last? No idea. I think people ask us every day. I never used to think about it. Never used to think about the future. We used to live for the day, you see. But everyone said, how long will it last? And you start thinking about it, but there's no answer. You just got to, I don't know, it remains to be seen, you know, that sort of thing.
Have you got a song for them when they get here?
Yeah.
Let's hear it.
We love you, Beatles. Oh, yes, we do. We don't love anyone as much as you. when you're not with us. We're blue.
What do you think of the comment that you're nothing but a bunch of British Elvis Presley?
Oh, it's not true. It's not true.
Are you trying to get a haircut while you're here?
Nope, no, thanks.
I had one yesterday.
That's no lie.
True, too.
No, I think he missed some.
No.
No, he didn't.
You should have seen him the day before.
What do you think the music does to these people?
I don't know.
Well,
pleases them, I think. Well, they must do, because they're buying
it. Why does it excite them so much?
We don't know, really.
We knew we'd form another group of the managers.
Public, 40 million American viewers.
That only looks like staring, one man to me.
Staring you right in the face.
Oh, it's the cameraman.
What is your impression of the American public? You've been here for a while now.
They're the wildest.
Why?
Well, I don't know. Tonight was, you know, marvelous, ridiculous. Well, there was 8,000 people all shouting at once, and we were trying to shout louder than them with microphones, and we still couldn't beat them.
And he said you had unresolved leading tones, a false modal frame, ending up as a plain diatonic. What would you say to that?
Well, we're going to see a doctor about that.
No, he's just copying this, the fella in the London Times.
Well, that's just rock and roll. It just happened to be right.
Well, what do you think made the difference that suddenly put you up above the other groups?
Well, we got a record contract.
I haven't stopped.
Come on,
hey, why don't the guys work back and show some snow on the ground, get a picture that looks like some...
Yeah, why don't you move back?
Come on, I got an idea.
John?
What's that, George?
Have you got
a cigarette for me, please? I think I've got one here for you, George. It's Marlboro.
I've just got a package.
With a micro knee finger.
Marlboro with a micro knee finger?
No.
Why? Thank you very much, John.
It's a big cigarette.
I will.
A big man.
Ha, I will light it down. We are smoking on
Marlboro. George. And
I love this place, America. It ain't good. On. The record's on radio. Lovely.
Are we going to get in?
You're missing a fat shot.
Hey, I'm missing the kids. Hey,
are we going to get in then?
Oh, hey, the
party. Hi,
everybody.
Lucky
door.
Hi, girls.
Hi, girls. This old man here going posse. Little old fellow that got the frozen one.
The horse is in front.
Get the horse. Come on.
Yeah, it's okay. He's going to get the horses behind us.
Not looking at all. I don't know. Anybody knew we'd come in? What's that?
The horse
with
the kick.
With the biggest little breed in all the land.
Is this it? Let's get in quick.
You said that bit about the news, man.
Well, you know, it's just funny half the time here. And everyone's so used to it that it doesn't look funny anymore in America. And there was this fella, and he's just doing the news the other night. And he said, and so that is the end of the news. You know, he didn't even say it was the end of the news. He said, and in China, the situation is very bad. Have you ever wondered when you're eating?
Thanks a lot.
Thank you. Thank
you. Are you American?
Alan,
what do you want to do?
Good luck tonight.
I'm great being here in New York. Okay? Oh, is that the place? I don't know. Washington. I'm just moving so fast.
Obviously enjoyed it over there. I assume the press enjoyed it. Did you enjoy it?
Yeah, it was marvellous. Yeah, everything, every bit of it was a knockout.
Even the work?
Yeah, we enjoyed it. You know, it was different. Yeah. You know, working in different places with the audience all around us, and, you know, it was a novelty.
What impressed you most about the place? Do you have time to take anything in properly?
Yeah. I don't know. I enjoyed the sun in Miami most of all. No, healthy.
Yeah. You're the healthy one of the four.
No, but the sun was sort of very healthy. Yeah, very healthy.
Did you have a chance to get away from anybody at any time on the trip?
Yeah.
You can't wait for me twice.
what did you most like about the trip, Ringo?
Oh, I just loved all of it, you know, especially Miami. The sun, you know. I didn't know what it meant until I went over there.
Didn't you get it up in Liverpool?
No, they finished up there, you know. Put it out.
Did you ever have a chance, John, to just get away on your own without anybody recognising you?
We borrowed a couple of millionaires' houses, you know.
Well, we did. You could afford to buy a couple of millionaires' houses, couldn't you?
No, John. We're soon to borrow them, it's cheaper. And we did a bit of water skiing. Well, sort of, anyway.
Yeah, we had a great time.
Did your wife enjoy it over there?
Yeah, she loved it. Who? Who?
Don't tell him he's married. It's a secret.
Oh, I'm sorry about that. I didn't need that. What about the... taste of the fans over there. Did you find the same stuff?
You never been
there. Yeah. We expected them to be very different, but they weren't at all.
Yeah.
The accent was the only thing, you know, it was the only difference. Lovely. Did they reckon you sang in an English accent or American?
No, accent? Some fella said, how come, because you're from Britain, and you still sing in American accent or something?
So
we've been trying to explain it to him.
We are American, accent. You know, believe it or believe it.
He can.
When you came back from France, you told me that they like to sort of quicker numbers.
Yeah.
But what do? You just do all the same routine as you do here?
Yeah.
We did the old songs. The records, the hits over there, are the ones that...
Oh, yeah, we had to do Please Please Me over there. Yeah. We haven't been doing that for a long time here, but it's in the charts.
That's history here.
It's unheard of interrupting a session of filming without good reason. The excuse here was that Radio Caroline was presenting its first birthday award, and it went to the Beatles. The records of the famous four have been in more demand on Radio Caroline than any others. Caroline's top disc jockey, Simon Dee, made the presentation and told the group all about the thousands of requests for their records that he receives. All this popularity doesn't go to their heads. They have enough hair to keep it out.
Listen.
On the air, stage, films, and now at sea, the Beatles ring the bell every time.
You feel that you exploit teenage talent?
No.
Talent?
No.
You can... I think I develop teenage talent rather than exploit it.
I think it's very difficult for him to affect the Beatles as far as taste goes. I think they admire him because clearly he's got some. They rather like the fact he has a Bentley and a Jaguar and a coloured manservant. They like the sort of riches and the glamour that his life seems to have. And they also like the fact that he talks differently.
When you signed and launched the Beatles, did you know, for example, or suspect that they might gross, as we believe they have, 5 million in 12 months?
I wouldn't have said that because I didn't think in terms of money, really. But I would have said that they would have been one of the biggest, if not the biggest, attraction, theatrical attraction in the world.
Ringo. Anyone who knows us knows I'm the one that never speaks, so I'd just like to say thanks a lot. I'd just like to say the same as the others. Thanks for the Purple Hearts.
Silver!
Oh, yeah. Sorry about that, Alan. We'd like to sincerely thank you all, and we've got to go now because the fella on the film wants us, and he says it's costing him a fortune. Thank you. Thanks.
So much love.
feel like to come back to a big civic reception like this?
Very nice.
Did you ever imagine that this day was coming?
Never like days? This. I mean, you know, we used to come here spotting the plane numbers and things. I never imagined, you know, we'd come back to this.
Well, now, you've all made a fortune. Have you got any future ambition in mind? Oh, no, I don't want to borrow any, John. Have you got any future in mind now? Any other ambitions?
I'd like to make more films, I think. We'd all like to do that, because it's good fun, you know. It's hard work, but you can have a good laugh in films.
What about you, Ringo?
Same, I enjoy films.
You do?
Well, I think, you know, all of us want to do sort of a good film, you know, one that we all think's good, and make more good records.
Don't you think this one's any good,
well,
then?
Well, it's okay, you know what I mean. But make good records,
not
I think.
Not as good as James Bond, though, is it?
Oh, not as good as James.
You fancy yourselves as actors, then, do you?
No, definitely not.
You?
But, I mean, but we enjoyed making the last film, and especially with the director. The director was great, you see, and it made it much easier for us. None of us rate ourselves as actors, but, you know, it's a good laugh and we enjoy doing it. So we'd like to make a couple more.
Jolly good. Now, it's about 7 months since you were in Liverpool last, appearing.
Officially.
Yeah. And some of the fans have been saying that, you know, they feel that you've deserted them. What do you feel about
that? They're mainly the ones that never came to see us. The people that are moaning about us not being here are people that never even came to see us when we were here. We could count on our fingers the original fans we had here, the ones that really followed us. And most of them gave up being teenagers anyway. They're all sort of settled in different things. The ones that are moaning never probably came to see us about once.
The only thing
or
is
after
that,
we'd made records.
The only thing is that we've got it. Do a lot from London, because a lot of the TV shows are down in London, you know, and so we're forced to do a lot down in London. I mean, it's like someone said the other day, why doesn't Harry Secombe go to Cardiff? You know, he never does, but no one ever moans about Harry never going to Cardiff. You know what I mean?
Doesn't he go now, Harry?
He doesn't go back to Cardiff very often.
Oh, no!
All right, fellas, give us
a chance. How does it feel to be married to a very famous man?
Very nice.
How do you think the other Beatles reacted?
Well, John and George were great, you know, they were happy and congratulated us and everything. And they, in fact, went to the wedding.
Oh, when are the rest of you going to get married?
When are the rest of them? I don't know. I've no idea.
Five teenagers from Pennsylvania petitioned Her Majesty the Queen to have the Beatles knighted. Well, this hasn't happened. But today I'm pleased to say that they have been made members of the most honorable order of the British Empire. Congratulations, John, George.
Thank you.
Tell me, how did you all react to this?
Well, I went...
Which means in car.
Whoopee.
You all live in well, good domestic splendor. Has this affected your writing, Paul and John?
No, it's easier to write with cushions and so on. You know, on pieces of hard bench, which you know we were on hard benches before we made it.
Yeah, in the slime and
grime. On the cellar of Liverpool, and it's much easier on a nice cushion.
The Beatles arrived in Japan today as their tour of the Far East continues. Across the Pacific in the United States, a furor is developing over comments John Lennon made. Quote, Christianity will go. It will vanish and shrink. We're more popular than Jesus, unquote. Here in Tokyo, violence broke out when right-wing fanatics demonstrated against the Beatles and their effect on Japanese youth.
This is Tony Charles. If you, as an American teenager, are offended by statements from a group of foreign singers which strike at the very basis of our existence as God-fearing, patriotic citizens, then we urge you to take your Beatle records, pictures, and souvenirs to the pickup points about to be named. And on the night of the Beatles' appearance in Memphis, August 19th, they will be destroyed in a huge public bonfire at a place to be named soon. Stay tuned to Wacky for further development.
Now, this religious controversy, I know you don't want to say too much about it, but does it worry you that it's going to boil up when you get to the States?
Well, it worries me, yes, but I hope everything will be all right in the end, as they say.
Do you think this is going to be a controversial tour like the Philippines was?
Oh, no. No, it's going to be fine.
We meant more to kids than Jesus did. Or religion at that time.
I wasn't knocking it or putting it down. I was just saying it as a fact.
John is deeply concerned and regrets that people with certain religious beliefs should have been offended in any way whatsoever.
It doesn't matter about people not liking our records or not liking the way they look or what we say. You know, they're entitled to not like us. We're entitled not to have anything to do with them if we don't want to, or not to regard them. You know, we've all got our rights, you know.
Big loud hello, fellas.
Hello!
John, are you sorry about what you said?
Accountable, of course, to all the citizens of Minneapolis, and we feel for the welfare and safety of their kids, even though they may be a little hysterical and they may go a little overboard for this type of thing. We know where our responsibility lies. As far as Beatle music, I could care about it not one bit myself personally. Some of the members of the troupe, Phil, became very indignant. They told us that Minneapolis was a very narrow-minded town, as were its police officials, and that other cities had been very tolerant to the parties that they had held in their rooms. One of their group with a British accent told me that they would never come back to Minneapolis, and I remarked to him that if they did not come, it would be too soon for me.
I would have liked them a lot. I really would have loved them if they just waved to us or something, but they didn't even look at us.
We came here at 6 o'clock in the morning, 5:30 to see them, and all they do is push you farther and farther away, and then they don't even let you see them.
You've been here since 6?
Yes.
Look, if we've got to back some of the people up, there's been two kids crushed already, they'll have to cancel the show. Down, everybody down, or no show. The Beatles want to perform for you, but they can't.
I think they might split up in 1967 because they're doing different things now. But I hope they don't.
At a studio in London, the Beatles have just come together for the first time in 4 months to record some songs.
Could you ever see a time when, in fact, you weren't working together?
I could see us working not together for a period, but we'd always get together for one reason or other. You need other people for ideas as well, but, you know.
See, it's gone downhill, performance, because we can't develop when no one can hear us, you know what I mean? So for us to perform, it gets difficult each time.
You mean they don't listen to you, and therefore you don't want to do that?
Oh, yeah, we want to do it, but if we're not listened to, then, and we can't even hear ourselves, then we can't improve in that. We can't get any better. So we're trying to get better with things like recording.
Are you getting bored of being the Beatles after all this time?
No. I'm having a great time. Merry Christmas to you. Long time since I've seen you.
Thank you very much, Ringo.
That's all right, thank you.
Are you going to work now?
Well, I'll see what they're up to. I think it may be tea time with any luck.
Tape and electronics have brought an enormous new feel to music. It's surprising what you can do once you have a sound recorded on tape. You can speed it up, you can slow it down, you can turn it round back to front, you can compress it, equalize it, add echo. There's a whole range of things you can do, which it would be obviously far too complicated to describe to you in detail.
Echoes I see, colors how I feel, space I can feel, everything's clear. I know that time waits for the one.
I really wish the people that look with anger at the weirdos, at the happenings, at the psychedelic freakout, would be unbiased about it. Because they really don't realize that what these people are talking about is something that they really want themselves. It's something that everyone wants. You know, it's personal freedom to be able to talk and be able to say things. And it's dead straight. It's a real sort of basic pleasure for everyone. But it looks weird from the outside. But it isn't.
Turn on, tune in, and drop out.
Had you spoken to him since you became interested this weekend?
I spoke to him Wednesday evening, the evening before we first saw Maharishi's lecture. And he was in great spirits.
And when did he tell you that he'd like to be initiated?
Well, when we arrived here on Friday, we got a telephone call later that day to say that Brian would follow us up and be here Monday.
Do you intend returning to Bangor before the end of this conference?
We probably won't have time now, because Maharishi will only be here till about Thursday, and we'll have so much to do in London that we'll have to meet him again some other time.
I understand that this afternoon Maharishi conferred with you all. Could I ask you what advice he offered you?
He told us not to get overwhelmed by grief, and to whatever thoughts we have of Brian, to keep them happy, because any thoughts we have of him will travel to him wherever he is.
Had he ever met Stretch?
No, but he was looking forward to meeting him.
They've got all these rules for everything, rules of how to live, how to paint, how to make music. And it's just not true anymore, you know. They don't work all those rules. There could be another answer, you know.
Well, do you think you have now encouraged your fans to take drugs?
I don't think it'll make any difference, you know. I don't think my fans are going to take drugs just because I did, you know. But the thing is, that's not the point anyway. You know, I was asked whether I had or not. And then from then on, the whole bit about how far it's going to go and how many people it's going to encourage is up to the newspapers and up to you, you know, on television. I mean, you're spreading this now at this moment. This is going into all the homes, you know, in Britain. And I'd rather it didn't, you know. But you're asking me the question. You want me to be honest. I'll be honest, you know.
But as a public figure, surely you've got a responsibility.
You've got the responsibility. You've got the responsibility not to spread this now. You know, I'm quite prepared to keep it as a very personal thing, if you will too. If you'll shut up about it, I will.
The message is, enjoy all the glories of outer life and also enjoy the honey of life present in the inner being.
We'd had enough acid. It had done all it could do for us. You know, there was no going any further. It only does so much.
What does it do?
Well, what it did, what it does mainly is, that is more of finding out about yourself, you know, and your ego and that kind of scene. So it's more psychological than anything else.
Whereas this is not psychological? I mean, it seems.
Well, it will be in the end, but I mean, well, if you have acid, it is just, you know, all about yourself. Am I? And did I? What? You know, it's all that. But this is just sort of a bit gentler.
We made a mistake.
The
other
people are
making
the mistake
of
going
to you now.
That's up to them. And we thought...
What?
We're human, you know.
What do you mean by a mistake?
That's
all, you know.
We thought there was more to him than there was, you know. But he's human. And for a while we thought he wasn't, you know. I thought he was,
It's business concerning records, films, and electronics. And as a sideline, whatever it's called, manufacturing or whatever. But we want to set up a system whereby people who just want to make a film about anything don't have to go on their knees in somebody's office, probably yours.
Married at last.
It feels fine, thank you.
What are you going to do now? Is it going to change your life much, do you think?
I don't know, really. I've never been married before.
The wedding was about an hour late starting. Everyone got a bit worried. What happened?
We were waiting for my brother, who was going to be bus man, Mike, and he was on British Railways, so he's a bit delayed by the weather and stuff.
Not a very nice day for you. Going away for a honeymoon?
Maybe. We haven't talked about it yet, you know. It's just, you know, we haven't really made any plans for honeymoon. I think we will in 2 days.
This is McCartney. Congratulations. What does it feel like to have just met with one of the most eligible bachelors in the world, with the envy of all the ladies?
It feels bad to be married.
We've got some acorns with us that we hope to give to all the heads of state we can get to see everywhere.
What are the acorns signifying?
They're symbolic of seed, which is symbolic of life, you know, and we'd like the presidents of different places to plant the seeds as a positive move towards peace instead of just shaking hands on photographs and talking about talks, about talks, about talks, about talks they're going to have about peace. I think they might think I'm going to hot up the revolution, you know, I want to cool it down.
You're against revolutionary violence too, eh? Like your song?
I'm against violence, you know, period.
Whether
you
know,
violence begets violence, as far as I'm concerned. It's been proved by what's going on in the States and the protest marches in Grosvenor Square in London. The only result of that was a lot of smashed heads and front page headlines about violence. And it wasn't the press's fault, nor the cops' fault, nor the minority left-wing students' fault, or whatever they're called, you know. It was just because the whole form they take doesn't work, you know. It doesn't work. Because that's what happens when you do that. And we're saying, this is one other way of doing it. This money, I'm using my money and my time to promote peace. And when the money runs out and the time runs out, we should have peace by then.
Yeah, you know, I just say, whatever, violence begets violence. And, you know, I don't believe in anything else. And I don't believe there's any park or anything worth getting shot for. And you can do better by moving on to another city or going to Canada or go anywhere. And then they've got nothing to attack and nobody to point a finger at. You don't need all that education. You don't need to get your whatever it is, exams that you're going to finish. What for? To turn into them? Just move off rather than get killed. Stay at home or stay in bed or make love, not war. That's all we're saying. Just remember that. You should keep up a constant, day-to-day, solid advertising campaign as they do to us. They are on all the time selling their war and selling their products. We must do the same. You're always just say entice them and con them. You know, you've got the brains and you can do it. What?
We can do it. We can make it.
You can make it, man. We can make it together. We can get it together. We can get it together. Now that's all.
Have you thought about your act for the show yet? Any change in the act, or is it going to be, you know, the usual routine?
No, we'll have to change it, I'm sure. We can't... No, stop it, isn't it? We'll have to change it, but we can't do the same thing all the time. We haven't thought about what we're going to do yet.
Suits with collars on? Brush party in
never
hair,
know.
Something like that?
It may not wear suits. Never know. We've no idea.
John, in this royal variety show, when you're appearing before royalty, your language has got to be pretty good, obviously. This thing about Ted Heath saying that he couldn't distinguish...
I can't understand
the Queen's English.
I can't understand Teddy saying that at all, really. I'm not going to vote for Ted.
You're not going to change your act just for the Lord Privy
Seal? Oh, no, like, we'll keep, like, the same kind of thing, like, won't we?
Oh, well, yes.
Yeah, that's right.
You're getting so much publicity nowadays from even the egghead papers are writing about you. Are you beginning to get a little bit worried that possibly you might be going over the top fairly soon?
No. When you gotta go, you gotta go.
Mm-hmm. What are you gonna do when your time comes?
Sail on the yacht. Yeah.
We haven't got any definite ideas what we're all gonna do.
Into college?
Yeah, it's my school scarf. Borstal High.
To protect your throat.
Yeah. There's nothing wrong. I always talk like this.
You're not thinking of giving up the big beat stuff and going in for some harmony singing, because one or two people said you're very good harmony.
Well, we do have noses.
There is harmony in the big beat, just happens to have a beat as well. All our records have had some kind of harmony on them.
I noticed in the Royal Show that you did one ballad number. Is this something you're going to do more of?
We've been singing it for about 5 years. And we've always done numbers like that, just that we're known for faster numbers.
Do you like the ballads?
Yes, they're good. Yeah, there's good, good ballads and good beats.
How did you learn?
Yeah.
wonderful.
How did you enjoy the Variety Show?
It was great. Fabulous. It was very good. Yeah, you know, the audience was much better than we expected.
Much taller.
Yeah.
Yeah, a very, very happy Christmas, and send me jacket back. It's cold.
John.
Gary Grimble and Manny Rudolph.
Ringer.
Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, see you soon.
Paul.
Lots of luck and many presents and Happy Grimble. That's all, I think.
With a song for Christmas. How about
okay.
That?
Gary Grimble to you, Gary Grimble to you. Gary Grimble, dear Rudolph, Gary Grimble, me too.
Rudolph the reindeer, had a very shiny nose. How many shiny
Okay. Happy Christmas, all the best.
Thank you.
They're funny, you see. There are more more boys than girls, and we miss the good old screams.
Yeah.
But, you know, there are quite a lot of shouts, but...
You mean they actually listen to you? That's the difference, is it?
Yeah. Yeah.
What's the French electrical supply like over there?
It's good, actually. Yeah, all the equipment's great. But on the first night, as you may know, we had a bit of trouble because... We suddenly found there was a radio program just sort of plugging into everything, and they'd overloaded all the amps and everything. It was just boom.
What's the sort of stuff they like over there on the parade?
Wilder stuff, I think.
Mm.
We stuck in a Wilder number.
Yeah.
You know, to finish off with.
Gone with the wind.
Gone with the wind.
They go for the Elvis Presley type of stuff, though, do they? I mean, they go for the old rock and roll stuff.
I think so. Yeah, a bit more. It depended really who was in.
You think
speaking French so much, you say?
What?
Je me lève, etc.
Yeah. You brushed up your French, have you?
No, kidding. I can't speak a word of it.
You still can't speak a word?
No. John's very good.
Je me lève.
Je bonsoir and all that sort of stuff. Very. Oh, he's very good.
Yeah, I hear that. You're going to give some poetry. Poetry recital.
Do.
I hear you're going to give some poetry recital.
Beethoven's poems.
Well, when's this? At the City of London Festival. I heard that you
were going to give... He knows, you see. It's a secret. Don't tell anybody.
What poems you're going to
give? Beethoven's.
I see.
You remember him? Beethoven.
Looking forward to this American trip. Have you had any reaction over there? You got any fan clubs going? Is there
well, there's one supposed to be started, and they're getting quite good response, you know. 12,000 letters a day.
But the Beatle movement's going over there,
is
it?
You can even be a Beatle booster, folks.
Yeah. I must tell you, by the way, that Detroit University have got to stamp out the Beatle movement.
I know.
Detroit. They think your haircuts are un-American.
Well, it was very observant of them, because we aren't American, actually.
True.
Where's Paul?
Thank you very much.
There's yours, John.
It's very nice indeed to get, especially to get one each, because we usually have a bit of trouble cutting them in four. I'd just like to say thank you very much. It's a great honour.
Thank you.
Now, Paul.
Same goes for me. Thank you very much for giving us this silver heart. But I still think you should have given one to good old Mr. Wilson.
Ring up. Anyone who knows us know I'm the one that never speaks, so I'd just like to say thanks a lot. I'd just like to say the same as the others. Thanks for the Purple Hearts. Silver! Sorry about that, Harold. We'd like to sincerely thank you all, and we've got to go now because the fella on the film wants us, and he says it's costing him a fortune. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Okay, lads, you're pretty regular top of the pollsters. What do you think about this election business?
Very good.
Crazy.
Yeah. Good stuff, this election stuff.
It's all right if you win.
Do you think it's harder being a politician than being a pop star?
Yes, definitely.
Probably. Very much so.
How's your father? Never been a politician, though.
What would happen if you got on this?
Never been.
What do you think is going to happen if you have to nationalise you, then?
Southern Ireland.
Well, we'll have to move out, won't we?
Yeah.
We'll have to go and live in Germany or someplace like that. Southern Ireland is nice down there.
It's only half an hour away.
Yeah.
Mind, in actual fact, had time to vote yourselves?
No, we missed it, actually. We were
having dinner at the time.
I think Paul has aspirations to become Prime Minister. Have you still got those ideas?
No, I'm not a politician. It's a hard life, you see. It's a hard day's grind.
He said in a merry voice.
Like a cigarette?
Don't smoke at all, thank you.
They're going up, you know.
I'll have to give those up,
sir. none of these luxuries.
You don't mind if we're smoke screen.
Bad enough as it is.
Have you been heckled at all? Have you ever...
Oh, yeah, we used to have it, and especially in the early days.
Oh, heckled.
But John had a perfect answer. What was it? Shut up.
I had the joke about the... No, that was the other day.
Now, just finally, one thing. What would you like to see a new government bring in?
More wine.
Yes, I think that's about it. More wine.
Better things for everyone, but I mean, that's what anyone wants anyway.
And cut the surtax a bit.
This is our computer, Ernie, who's going to prophesy the verdict.
Thank you very much, lads.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Have you met any interesting American girls?
Not yet. We're hoping.
What do you think of the police protection you've been receiving here in the city?
It's marvellous. They're doing a great job, you know, looking after us.
Are the crowds as large as you expected?
No, we didn't expect anything like this, no.
What's the most interesting offer you've ever received?
Oh, yes. Had a lot of interesting offers, actually. No comment.
Well, happy birthday, Ringo. Any good presents?
A few, you know. Quite a few.
Anything particular?
No, just the fans sent me a lot of cards and dolls and rings and all. Oh, I got one funny one from America, a bull ring. No, off a bull's nose. I don't know if that's an insult or what.
Paul, it's your dad's birthday today.
Yes.
Tell us about the horse.
Happy birthday, Dad. I got him a horse because he loves horse racing and he's always watching telly and making bets and things. So I bought him a horse, which he likes very much. Drake's running the Chester next Saturday.
George,
yeah.
How did you feel the premiere went last night?
Great. I enjoyed it because we'd seen the film before on Saturday, and none of us were, you know, very excited until we saw it with the audience, and it was great.
It's quite a scram.
You know, it's much better with all the people laughing and booing.
John, what's the next big event then?
Friday, the premiere in Liverpool, which we're looking forward to. That's the next big event. I don't know what happens after that.
Well, thank you all very much. Best of luck.
Thank you.
Gentlemen, first of all, many congratulations on your MBE. The whole country seems very delighted indeed, but how do you feel about it, Paul?
Delighted indeed? You know, I'm glad everyone's delighted. I love it.
But, I mean, is it fun for you?
Or? Yeah, of course. I mean, you know, it'd be fun for you, wouldn't it? You know, you just woke up one morning and he said, "M-b-eh." You know, it's great.
Ringo, how did you first hear about it?
Well, we heard about it 6 weeks ago when we got the forms to fill in, and then we knew that we were going to get it 2 days ago, officially.
How did these forms come? What, straight through the post or in the fan mail or what?
I don't, just in brown envelopes. Yeah, they were delivered by somebody, you know, by hand. I think one of Brian's secretaries.
I'll tell you.
All right.
They were sent from the Prime Minister Downing Street to our manager's office, and they were delivered from there to Twickenham, where we were filming, and then
filming help
about the day later we just found them, and we thought we were being called up for the army, and then we opened them and we found out we weren't.
We were all said that one.
I know, but this is at ITV. The other
was the other one.
Why is the MBE awarded then?
I don't know.
No idea.
In fact, you know, I know nothing about it. It's just that we've got it, and it's nice to have, and it doesn't make you more respectable or anything, I don't think. Maybe other people think it does. It doesn't make me any more respectable. I'm still a scruff.
Well, I was wondering about that. Ringo, how do you feel about going to the palace in a morning suit and all that?
I don't mind, you know. It's all right. When I buy one.
You haven't got one?
No, not yet. I've got an evening suit. That'll do.
I don't think it will.
Morning suit.
Well, I'll just go in my pyjamas then.
We got to the airport, and our road manager had a lot of trouble trying to get the equipment in because the escalator's been turned off. So we got there and we got put into the transit lounge. And then we got pushed around from one corner of the lounge to another, you know.
You treat like ordinary passenger. Passenger, they're saying. There's an ordinary passenger. He doesn't get kicked, does he?
And so they started knocking over our road managers and things, and everyone was falling all over
the place. They started worrying you when the road manager got knocked over.
Yeah, and I swear there was 30 of them.
What do you say they were?
Well, I saw five in sort of outfits, you know, that were sort of doing the actual kicking and booing and shouting.
Did you get kicked in?
No, I was very delicate and moved every time they touched me.
Would you go to Manila again, George?
Oh, no, I didn't even want to go that time.
Me too.
No, because we'd heard that it was a terrible place anyway, and when we got there, it was proved.
We're just in it as drawings, and it's like us animated goes through it, you know.
But did Mystery Tour put you off making a film completely yourselves?
Yeah, we're only ever going to be cartoons forever now, because they really put us off those.
It's a new career piece.
Those no-good damn critics.
The film makes, the cartoon makes a bit of fun of the Maharishi. Does this mean that you've finished with him now?
He's well, it's not, not finished with, you know, but we're over that phase. It was a bit of a phase. But he's still a nice fella and everybody's fine, but we don't go out with him anymore.